succeed Jakobson from the American continent, who would be counted on to develop the fund in a positive way, is Mr. Louis Rosminski, who in the past 2 years has been picking up the pieces at the Bank of Canada and earning new respect in the process. The magazine noted that he combined technical ability and economic expertise with notable personal qualities and is a popular figure, and went on to describe him as the best man available for what should be the free world's number one economic position. There were a number of major developments and challenges that had to be addressed during Lowe's term as governor. The first involved the value of the Canadian dollar in the foreign exchange crisis in 1962. Given the weakness of the Canadian economy at the time, the Diefenbaker government tried to talk down the value of the Canadian dollar in order to increase exports and reduce imports. Eventually, in May 1962, the float of the dollar was abandoned and the dollar was repegged at 92.5 US cents, in line with the international norms of those days and conforming to those requirements. In 1963, the Liberal minority government under Lester Pearce was elected, with Walter Gordon as finance minister. The subsequent expansion of fiscal policy and developing inflationary psychology meant that the lone voice preaching restraint was that of the Bank of Canada. There were also a series of major challenges in those next few years resulting from U.S. economic problems on the international scene. Actions taken by the U.S. in response to these problems threatened to sideswipe the Canadian economy. It's like that classic argument of the U.S. has a cold and Canada gets pneumonia. Who played a crucial role in minimizing the effects of such American actions on the Canadian economy? In each case, he was involved in negotiations with U.S. officials and the U.S. government and played an important role in bringing about a satisfactory outcome as could have been expected in the circumstances. What effectively would happen in all these cases, this would be 1963, 1965, and again in 1968, was that Canada was exempted from the U.S. initiatives and controls in return for a quid pro quo on the part of Canada that ensured that the U.S. controls would not be circumvented internationally through Canada. A very important development in Lou's second term was the refloating of the Canadian dollar exchange rate in May 1970, in spite of opposition from the United States and the IMF. In the following year, in 1971, President Nixon untied the U.S. dollar from the gold standard and introduced an import surcharge of 10%. While the U.S. pressured Canada to re-peg its exchange rate, Canada refused, and the pressure eventually disappeared. 2 years later, in 1973, Canada was followed by much of the industrialized world as the fixed exchange rate system originally established in Bretton Woods finally collapsed. On a personal level, during those years, Lou was awarded a number of honorary doctorates, joined the board of Carleton University, on which he served for 9 years, was awarded the Outstanding Achievement Award of the Public Service of Canada, and was named Companion of the Order of Canada. He was also invited to give the 1966 Poor Jakobson Lecture, a very prestigious annual lecture sponsored by the IMF to honor its late managing director. He chose the title, The Role of the Central Banker Today. His 45-minute wide-ranging lecture was a great success. Both of his discussants commented on the excellence of the paper, and in his closing remarks, the president of the Poor Jakobson Foundation noted that the response of this audience is a clear indication that Mr. Rosminski has made a most successful presentation of this subject. In the latter part of the 1960s and the early 1970s, the focus of the Bank of Canada increasingly turned to fighting inflation. This was not just a Canadian problem, it was part of a global problem. And it took more than two decades before inflation was finally brought under control. Lou was very concerned about inflation and the long-run effects it would have on the function of the economy, because of the distortions it would generate and the inflationary expectations that would become entrenched, while being aware of the short-run consequences for output and unemployment in fighting against inflation. But it was also uncertain about the extent to which monetary policy could succeed in preventing these pressures from taking hold. One prescient comment from Lou's 1966 Per Jakobson lecture is worth noting in the context of the developing global inflation problem. It seems to me that what is needed is not to decide how much inflation can be tolerated, but to concentrate on trying to find ways of making the economy work at satisfactory levels without rising price levels. It is clear we have a lot to learn about living with prosperity without permitting it to generate into inflation. He also commented pessimistically in the early 1970s that in a certain sense, I think it is really impossible to succeed at the job of being a central banker under today's conditions, when economic arithmetic counts for so little and all the social and economic pressures favor inflation. Modern societies do not have the stomach to push monetary and fiscal policy to the point where market conditions will begin to bring inflation to an end. And in 1973, he wrote, "We are again, at least in my opinion, threatened with a degree of inflation which can undermine the achievements of the past quarter century." Prime Minister Pierre Trudeau wrote to Liu upon the announcement in November 1972 of his upcoming retirement, "The last 2 or 3 years have been ones of extraordinary difficulty for those responsible for financial or economic advice and policy. The governor of the bank has a position of unique responsibility and must have constituted a very great burden to you at many times. It was a great advantage to the government to know that decisions in this extremely important, in the extremely important financial matters with which you are charged were being taken by a person of such capacity, integrity, and dedication to public good." Liu retired on February 1st, 1973, on his 65th birthday, following Lila's being diagnosed with cancer. Liu's retirement was an active one. He served for 4 years as head of the IDRC, the International Club Research Center, succeeding Lester Pearson in this position. It allowed Liu to maintain an active interest with third world nations. He also worked with the Canadian Jewish Committee in a variety of causes. For example, he sat as the Canadian board member of the Jerusalem Foundation at the request of Teddy Kollek. He was also honorary national chairman of the Bora Laskin Endowed Scholarship to fund the Yeshiva University. He was the honorary chairman of the Canadian Gathering of Holocaust, Jewish Holocaust Survivors and Their Children in Ottawa. In 1981, Liu was the honoree at a special tribute fundraising dinner in Ottawa at Ben Gurion University with the objective of raising money to sustain the Louis Rosminsky Social Integration Endowment Fund. The funds from the endowment were used to ameliorate the condition of Sephardic Jews. In the first number of years, the funds and resources were directed to helping Ethiopian youngsters. Liu died in September 1998 at the age of 90. I want to finish my remarks with a couple of examples of Liu's delightful sense of humor. Every year, just before Christmas, the Bank of Canada invites past and senior officials to what is called the Old Guard Lunch. At this event, the current governor talks about monetary policy developments and other developments of the Bank of Canada in the year just passed. And the oldest former governor present responds to the current governor's presentation. At one such luncheon, I remember Liu beginning his remarks by apologizing for his longevity being a drain on the Bank of Canada's pension plan. And then going on to explain that his plan was to continue to be such a drain for a number of years. As I mentioned, following his retirement, Liu was the honoree at a fundraising event for Gregory University. One of the speakers at the event was Gerald Bowie, who had succeeded Liu as governor. In his remarks, Jerry recalled the occasion during the period when Liu was governor and he was senior deputy governor. He received a note from Liu, which read as follows: "I will not be at work tomorrow since Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, the holiest day of the Jewish calendar. It is a day on which we fast and pray for forgiveness for sins of commission and omission, of which there were none this past year in monetary policy." Liu Rosminsky was a wonderful man, a great Canadian, and one of whom the Canadian Jewish community was justly proud. As his biographer Bruce Muirhead wrote, Rosminsky overcame great odds to become governor in 1961 following the Coin Affair, and in the process demonstrated great reserves of character. But that strength was not surprising, given his background and experience. The very fact of being Jewish, which had prevented him from becoming governor earlier, had long ago given him the ethical and moral fiber to deal with life. Back to you, Rabbi.
Thank you very much, Chuck. What you succeeded in doing is convincing us, not that we needed convincing, that this was a truly giant of a person, a truly great man, and those of us who are blessed to be in his generation, we realize now retroactively how lucky we are, how lucky we were, and how lucky Canada was and continues to be because of him. It is now a great pleasure to call on Liu's dear son, Michael, who is Emeritus Professor of Neurology at McGill University. What's emeritus? I don't even know what emeritus means. Right. And he's senior physician at Montreal General Hospital and a lovely guy.
Thank you. those of you who didn't hear what it means to be an emeritus professor, it means I'm an AK. Where's Chuck? Thank you for that lovely talk about Dad. You and I have just a basically nodding acquaintance, but in fact we go back a very long time. I was 11, 12 years old. I had Hebrew lessons from Rabbi Kravitz, and I can remember going to his house on Sunday mornings and seeing a pigtailed young Aviva hiding behind her mother's skirts. And now we're both in a case. Time passes. I made a couple of notes as Chuck was talking. You were talking about the meeting of the IMF, where Keynes came down the stairs, and I was going to tell that story until you told it. But I have another story to tell about Dad's getting the job in Geneva, which you may not know. He was 22 at the time, I guess, and this job was advertised in the billboard at the London School of Economics. And there was an interview. He made the shortlist and got to the interview. The interview started in English, and that went well, and then continued in French, which he spoke, and that went well. And then they switched to German, which was a lingua franca at the time. And Dad spoke pretty good Yiddish. And his German wasn't bad. It was Ontario High School German, and that went well. And then somebody in the panel said to him, "Do you speak Spanish?" Didn't speak Spanish, but he figured he was on a roll, and he figured that nobody on the panel spoke Spanish. He said, "Well, I have a little Spanish." They didn't question him in Spanish, and he did the job. I'm very pleased that Gordon Thiessen is also going to speak. Dad was treated very warmly by his three successors as the governor of the bank. He was particularly pleased that his deputy governor, Jerry Bowie, became his successor. John Crow was the next governor, and I always slightly had the feeling that he was usurping my status as his favorite son. My sister Lola, who could not be here today, but you'll hear from her in a bit. I see her on the screen ahead of me. Still very good friends with John and Ruth Crow in Toronto. I have less insight into Dad's relationship with you, Mr. Thiessen, but I do recall one memorable encounter with you. I think the only one we've ever had. I went into the bank shortly after Dad died to pick up some of his personal papers, and you got wind of the fact that I was in the bank and invited me to come into your office, Dad's old office, for a talk. And I remember what you said. You recalled an incident when you were a young researcher in the research department, and you'd written a paper, Dad took you aside after it was presented and was very complimentary about it. He wasn't complimentary so much about the substance of the paper, but about the deft way you'd use language in writing it, and that was something he cared about a great deal. I have a quote here. This preoccupation with language is perhaps best epitomized in something he wrote many years later. When he was summarizing his experience as the chair of the drafting committee of the Articles of Agreement of the International Monetary Fund, and Chuck has spoken of that, he says, "I take a certain pride in the coherence and virtual absence of unintended ambiguities in this complicated document." So, Mr. Thiessen, you perhaps qualify as number three favorites. When Tobel Lynch asked me to speak at this event, I was in a bit of a quandary about what would be appropriate to say. There's really no precedent for an occasion like this. So let me just share with you a few random personal recollections. Chuck referred to Dad having grown up in a rich Jewish milieu in Kensington Market area of Toronto. And he's talked about some of his young activities in Jewish life. One of the things he did was to spend a couple of summers as a counselor at Camp Moden, which was known as the camp of the Jewish ideal, which my father said freely translated mean they didn't pay their counselors. And he never spoke to me about this, but apparently he thought at one point of becoming either a rabbi or an academic. Those for him were the roads not taken. For me, the roads not taken was a career in musical theater, which I didn't take, but to my mother's eternal relief. Nonetheless, after a dalliance with that in university and in medical school, I continued to keep my hand in from time to time, writing songs for family occasions, like my father's 75th birthday. And I can't forgo the opportunity to quote just a fragment of the lyrics from the song that I wrote that Lola and I sang together on that occasion. And perhaps if Lola's mic's turned on, she can chip in at the appropriate point. I won't sing, but I should tell you that as an academic myself, I understand the imperative of recirculating one's material. Lou thought one time he'd be a scholar, but he wound up signing dollars. What a thing to do, from Kensington and Brunswick. Lou even thought he'd be a rabbi, but our mother said, "Have I another thought or two on what a Jew should do?" Pulpit academe forsworn, bureaucrats are made, not born. In the end, it turned out fine for your father. And for mine, she's supposed to say. And 15 years later, we were celebrating his longevity on his 90th birthday. Here's a selection song from that. He's a true world-class survivor. This nonagenarian man, he's the oldest central banker alive, unless Jakobson's surfaced in Azerbaijan. He can still contrive to be youthful, despite his enormous lifespan, this nonagenarian, non-Alzheimerian man. Our nonagenarian, non-Alzheimerian, never Rotarian or Rastafarian, nonagenarian, soon centenarian pa.